I only have one message to give you. I don't care what you think of me. I don't care what you call me. I do care what you do with this information, because it is important to our survival as a species.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, we are doing a lot of new things, and we have a lot of things to talk about, and a lot of things are changing, and I got to tell you, we're really super busy here, and we're going to get busier and busier and busier. Aaron Russo is going to be heading up a television show soon, which I believe is going to be called Aaron Russo is Mad as Hell or something like that. And he's going to be pushing the Constitution Party and constitutional ideas on the show on television. So the leadership of the Constitution Party at the present time is being shifted over to my shoulders until such time as we can get a board of directors together that can pick whoever they want. If it's me, fine. If it's somebody else, that's fine too. But in the interim, I'm taking the leadership of the Constitution Party. All inquiries and requests for information should be directed here to our telephone number and to our address. And until I give you a new phone number and a new address, which we will have shortly, just to keep all the money straight and everything legitimate, 100% legitimate, so that the party doesn't get in any kind of trouble. I certainly don't want anything to go awry on my watch. So, also, I'll be going back to Kansas City on the 6th and the 7th, representing the Constitution Party, to meet with the heads of all the other third parties and to implement action on the resolution that we drew up and approved December the 2nd and 3rd at the meeting held in Kansas City at that time. So all of these things are transpiring now. We'll ask that you give us a little bit of slack while we get all these things squared away and underway, if you will. And also, on the Communist Donahue show this morning, Mr. Commie in the Media Donahue had a program on the militia. And I don't really know how that went because it came on so early here after being up half the night. I missed it. We're going to have open phones tonight. If you want to talk about that or anything else, you're welcome to do it. Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill?
Yes?
Howard, calling from Philadelphia area.
Hello, Howard.
I got a quick question for you. I tuned into you last week, and I caught the tail end right at the beginning of the hour when you were talking about Sam Sherwood.
Yes.
And if I heard you correctly, you were saying something that... Was he making racist statements, or was somebody on the air with him making statements?
No. Somebody called in and asked whether Jews should be allowed in the militia.
Right.
The gist of the conversation was that the militia is Christian. Jews are waging war on Christians. The country is Christian. And then somebody called in later and asked about the Trockmans, his relationship to the Trockmans of the militia of Montana. And he said that he didn't think that the Trockmans belonged to the Aryan Nations, but they were certainly sympathetic to their views, which in our investigations we've discovered is true also. The Trockmans are carrying baggage that they should not be carrying, and if they care about the militia, they should step down and let somebody else lead, in our estimation. Sam Sherwood then made the statement that if you're a Christian, you're going to fit into the same category, and if you're in the militia, you're going to fit into the same category. So what he was saying basically was this country is Christian. The militia is Christian. Jews are waging war on Christians. And if you're a Christian or if you're in the militia, you're going to fit into the same category as the thought or the view of the Aryan Nations. In other words, Jews aren't welcome.
Are you familiar with the what's going on in Philadelphia with the Sons of Liberty?
No, I'm not.
And the Sons of Liberty is a libertarian group offshoot from in this area. They brought in Sam Sherwood to speak at one of the meetings.
Uh-huh.
Hear what he had to say. The newspaper, the Philadelphia Inquirer, took the opportunity to vilify the Sons of Liberty by not saying that they were racist per se, but that there was a group in California, also by the same name, that were known to be racist, and ended up vilifying quite a number of good people. And I was just curious as to whether or not, I hadn't heard that particular show that Sam Sherwood was on.
Yeah, order the tape, listen to it. It's blatant. It's like they're playing charades and saying something else. You know what I mean?
So what's your suggestion then? I mean, who is actually good in this movement and who is bad?
Well, there's no bad guys anywhere. There are people who have certain beliefs that they have a right to have in this country. But if they have those beliefs, it is not good for the country or the militia for them to be in leadership positions. Anyone who is racist in any way, to any degree, anyone who is a convicted felon for any reason, no matter whether they paid their dues or not, it's against the law for a convicted felon to own a weapon. To be a member of a militia, you have to own a weapon. It's not good press. We're going to be attacked from every front, from everybody, from every media, from every newspaper, every television network, and we don't need to give our enemies ammunition to use against us. Anybody who's putting out disinformation or reams of paper saying there's 50,000 communist Chinese troops in Wyoming and all this kind of crap, we should not allow to be the head of any militia unit in this country because they're spreading lies.
Can I answer your question that you put out about the Donahue show? I caught part of that. And I can tell you that what happened on that show was that you had a bunch of people up there, and I don't know much about who they were. They did seem to present themselves pretty well, but to a very unreceptive audience who cared nothing for what was written in the Constitution. Now, I've never seen so many people in one room kind of scoff at the fact that these people actually were reading parts of the Constitution.
Well, you have to understand that Donahue is a socialist, well-known socialist. In fact, I think he's way beyond socialist. I believe he's a communist. And he hangs out with this guy, Posner, who used to be a reporter, a journalist for the Soviet Union. In fact, they even have a late-night show together. And I've never seen them disagree about anything. And I know that Donahue and Geraldo and some of the others, I don't think that Oprah does it, but I know that Donahue and Geraldo and some of the others actually choose the audience or send out special invitations to people who they know have certain viewpoints or who will react in a certain way when they present certain shows.
Sounds like a Clinton, one of Clinton's fireside chats or one of his...
absolutely, yeah.
...that he was doing where he actually picked the audience.
Yeah.
I mean, that certainly wouldn't be surprising.
But anybody who would call himself an American, who would laugh when someone reads the Constitution, is a fool. They're worse than a fool. They are the thickest-headed sheeple fools that I can possibly imagine. They don't even understand that the reason that they could go there and sit in that audience and have the viewpoints that they have is because the Constitution protects their right to do that. But that's neither here nor there. They don't understand that and never will. They're stupid.
I'll give you an interesting anecdote. One of the people locally who was part of one of the watchdog groups that kind of watch these racially motivated Ku Klux Klan and whatnot, made a comment to me personally when one of the people from our group, from the Libertarian Party, attended one of their meetings discussing this whole issue of whether or not the group locally here in Philadelphia was racist.
Mm-hmm.
It was all a lot of hullabaloo, but the woman who went there, she's probably listening to the show, went and took with her a constitution which she kept in her pocket. And the woman that I spoke to on the phone, who was the head of the watchdog group, made a comment to me, not really knowing who I was. And her comment was, she says, and there was this very strange woman who was there from the group in question. And what I found the most strange was that she had a constitution in her pocket and actually read from it. And I thought to myself, I said, well, gee, what's so strange about that? I said, and did she need a license to carry this thing?
That's pretty good. Pretty good.
We have become.
Yeah.
Where somebody is incredulous that they would, somebody would actually carry a constitution in their pocket.
Yeah, it's just amazing how people have been dumbed down to the point they don't even understand who they are, what they are, where they came from, what gives them the rights, the protection of the rights to do the things that they do, to make a living, to go where they want to go, to say what they want to say, to be free. I'll tell you, sometimes it makes me, I'm not even going to tell you what I do, but I really I got to go somewhere every once in a while, just sit down and cry. It's disgusting.
And sometimes you wake up in the middle of the night and you just wonder to yourself, you know, where did it all go wrong?
Yeah.
But I have a feeling it went wrong long before I was born.
Well, I think it went wrong long before a lot of us were born, but it doesn't relieve us of the responsibility for what's happened and for what's happening.
No, but I think it's greatly accelerating.
Oh, of course. There's going to be world government, and we're going to be the slaves in that government. And yes, it's accelerating. And you'll find that the more people who begin to wake up and threaten this goal, the faster it will accelerate, and the more danger we will find ourselves in.
Well, what do you think our greatest weapon is besides actual firearms?
Education. Education.
Do you see the tremendous increase in the cyberspace, the ability to exchange information quickly as one of those main weapons?
Yeah, but I see a lot of blocks to being able to do that. And if you've ever been on the computer networks, you recognize how that's done by who. But the biggest weapon that we have besides actual weapons is education. The more people we can educate, the faster we can wake people up, the quicker that they understand what's happening in the position that we're in, the quicker that we can get them armed with real weapons and into some kind of a militia. And don't worry about all these attacks by the press and the media. The quicker we can get involved in things like the Constitution Party and the effort of all the third parties to actually field a viable presidential candidate for the 96th election. If we can get involved in all of these things, try every peaceful solution that we possibly can, and at the same time prepare for the ultimate solution if it comes to that.
Well, I think you're correct, but I want to make one note before I go. I'm in possession of a publication from the pediatricians. It's a pediatricians group, and it was sponsored by Squibb, the drug maker. And what they called forth in this 50-page pamphlet, which was a supplement to pediatricians, was a complete guide to pediatricians on how to teach young parents and their young patients that guns are bad, that guns are evil, guns should not be in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that we have, if we keep this arguing back and forth with the current media, I think that this current generation of people who are out there is a lost generation. But if people don't watch it and find out what these kids are being taught in school and what these kids are being told by the supposed role models who are their pediatricians, I think what we're going to find is we're going to find an entirely huge crowd of citizens, and I use that term loosely, who are going to think nothing of trampling on one right after another because that's all they know.
Well, you may be right, but I don't think anybody's lost. I found that people that I thought were just absolutely hopeless, if I had a chance to sit down with them, and if they were in the least bit receptive, and I could start at like ground zero, like absolute first grade nothingness, and work up from that, and sort of slowly open their eyes, I've been able to turn a lot of those people around, but it's difficult. It requires time. It requires effort. And a lot of you people out there have a lot more of that time than I do because I'm concentrating on masses of people. You can sit down and actually spend an hour with one individual. It's a lot easier for you to do that than it is for me to do that. But anyway, thank you for calling. You brought up some good questions and some good points, and you certainly had some good input. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Good night. The number is 602-337-2524, and this goes out to Norm Olson, commander of the Michigan, get my lips in the right position, Michigan militia from his sweetheart. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, I am so sick and tired of these individual exceptions. The rest of America, according to you, is running around in an idiotic panic, and only you have kept your head. The other day I spoke to a man who was the only one that was is exempt from this insidious or something or other.
Now, I've just turned off your pot because first I want you to tell us, what are you talking about?
I'm talking about all of you and the patriotic group. That's what I'm talking about. I'm so darn...
You're talking about all of us and the patriotic movement. And you're telling us not to generalize and not to do this and that? Are you there? Hello? Well, another little poopy-diapered socialist bites the dust. If you're an American, you're a patriot. Since you're not in the patriotic movement, you must not be an American. If you're not an American, you must be some kind of a pukey, dirty, diapered socialist. Yes, we are right when it comes to people like you. You're what's destroying this country. You don't even know who you are or what gave you the ability to call up a radio program and say what you just did. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening. How are you tonight?
Just fine. Turn your radio off, please.
I'll be happy to do that. There we go. I'd like to just read you about three quick lines out of a book I'm reading right now called Patriots, The Men Who Started the American Revolution. Have you read it?
No, I haven't.
Just a quick couple lines out of there. A Grecian philosopher who was lying asleep upon the grass was aroused by the bite of some animal upon the palm of his hand. He closed his hand suddenly as he awoke and found that he had caught a field mouse. As he was examining the little animal who dared to attack him, it unexpectedly bit him a second time and made its escape. Now, fellow citizens, what think you was the reflection made upon this trifling circumstance? It was this, that there is no animal, however weak and contemptible, which cannot defend its own liberty if it will only fight for it. Good night, sir.
Thank you. Very good. And it's also very true. And you'll notice, folks, that there's a lot of propaganda coming out of a lot of different sources trying to scare you into submission that you can't possibly resist. Got news for you. You can. Just watch what they do all around the world. How many of you heard that they're pulling the United Nations troops, which means the United States Army, out of Somalia because it's getting too dangerous for them? Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, hi, Mark here from New York State. Hey, I'd like to bring something up. If you remember around when Jeffrey Dahmer first made the news, there was a black alderman from Milwaukee who made Larry King and Phil Donahue, and he was on the news quite a bit. And he claimed he was the leader of the Black Panthers, and that if by 1995, if they didn't get what they feel they deserve, as in war reparations sort of thing, that he said 1995 that they were going to start assassinations and bombings. So there's a factor. And just one other thing is that I'd like to point out, I'm going to hang up.
Well, wait a minute. What is your point with that?
Well, how I believe is that... At some point or another, there's going to be some form of social turmoil in the United States.
Absolutely, yes.
And that's just the excuse that the president needs to start their police state.
They've already started the police state. They need something to legitimize it, because so far it ain't legitimate.
Yeah, yeah. But where I'm tying it, also this in, is that... a few other talk shows, they like to talk about Bill Clinton being put out of office in a few months or less than a year or whatever. And but from what I understand is that Al Gore is more of a police state sort of a person.
Yeah, but all that is rhetoric. It means nothing. It solves nothing. If you're talking about Rush and that ilk, he spends every day, all day, just calling the president names and all kinds of stuff like that. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's wasted time. You're even wasting your breath even thinking about things like that.
Yeah, but...
That's a diversion.
Yeah, yeah. So you don't think that the Black Panthers under this guy will start a rebellion, so to speak?
You know, I know a lot of black people, and I don't know any of them that are stupid.
Yeah, yeah. I've got friends who are black, too, and...
Are they stupid?
Well, the crack dealers that used to hang out in front of my house were, and they always seemed to rotate from in jail to out of jail, but... besides that, I have some really good friends who are black. And,
crack dealers are interested in money. They're not interested in bombing anybody. They want to get rich.
Yeah, yeah.
Usually,
you know, this country is in really a sad state, and it's really kind of a drag how the politicians are just selling us out. And, you know, I hate to say it. I talk to my friends, you know, and I've been reading the Bible for quite a number of years, and I make the point that, hey, something... is up and something just might break, and I think that people either don't want to believe it, either because they hope that it doesn't happen, or they think that it probably won't happen. But there is scriptural evidence to point to the end times.
Well, wait a minute. It's not a religious program. You practice your religion if you want to, but don't preach it on this broadcast.
Oh, okay, sure.
Okay.
Well, okay. Have a good night, and I enjoy your broadcast.
Thank you very much, and thank you for calling.
Yep.
Folks, even if I agree with your religion, I don't want it going out over this broadcast. You see, I believe in the freedoms that the Constitution guarantees. I believe that somebody has the right to worship at the altar of the devil if they want to. It is between them and God what happens to their soul. It's not for me or you to judge. And I think we'd all be a lot better off if we quit trying to shove what we believe down everybody else's throat. I also believe that a lot of Christians would lead their life by example rather than by judging other people. More people would want to become Christians. What do you think about that? Good evening. You're on the air.
That is so true. That is so true. I find it hard myself to keep at times from judging others, being a Christian myself. But yet I try my best to strive and keep from doing that. I recorded the Donahue show. Well, my wife did it for me. Missed the first 10 minutes. They on purposely left out parts of the Second Amendment when they displayed it. The right of the people, they left out of the people. They had a representative of the ADL and someone with a handgun control group, not Handgun Control Incorporated, it's another group, Handgun Violence, that's what it was. The people, even though they had a representative from the Montana militia there, they seemed to control themselves quite well. They also had a black man there who mentioned to the ADL that there were Jewish people that were in their militia whose parents and grandparents had warned them that this is exactly what the Nazis did before they started implementing their gun control, you know, and their socialist agendas to control the people.
That's right.
And we're seeing a lot of it right now. Now, I don't really recall anybody there talking about the one world government except for the ADL. He kept on mentioning that, and so did Donahue, over and over and over again, trying to make these people look like a bunch of paranoids. Now, also, the audience...
They should have had my stack of treason documents with them. They could have thrown them right in Donahue's face and said, here's the proof.
Uh-huh.
Read it, dummy.
The majority of the audience seemed kind of young. I was wondering, it looked like they went to a college frat.
Doesn't matter where they went, they stacked the deck.
Yeah.
What they had in the audience were people that they knew were stupid, never read the Constitution, didn't know from where their rights came, or being indoctrinated by the television and everything else, and probably by their college, that no national boundaries is good, that you don't need a Constitution, that it's old and outdated, written over 200 years ago by old men who didn't understand the complexities of the modern age. By the way, that's a direct quote. From guess who?
Communist Manifesto?
No.
Who?
No. Who was the spoiler in the last election?
Clinton.
No. Clinton won the election.
Who was the spoiler?
Who split the conservative vote?
Oh, Perot.
Perot, that's right. Direct quote from Mr. Perot for all of those of you out there who think that he's on our side and think you're going to vote for him again. Anyway.
I wonder who would be worth voting for. Yes, I will take in serious consideration a representative from your party that you're forming, the Constitution Party.
Good, because I don't know if you heard the show, but we drafted a resolution in Kansas City with all the different third parties, everybody except the Republicans and Democrats, although we did have a representative of the Republican Party there who did agree with us, but he did not have the power to, of course, make the whole rest of the Republican Party go along with it. But everybody else did, and we agreed that we're going to field a constitutionist candidate for the 96th election, and our platform will be the Constitution of the United States of America and the protection of the rights of an individual to be an individual.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of the people on the panel was a pastor, and he provided a video of one of his sermons. They deliberately cut into a section that was trying to make it look like that the militia was considering itself only a Christian militia.
Well, unfortunately, that's exactly what's coming out of the mouth of a lot of leaders of the militia, and it's got to stop. The militia consists of all able-bodied citizens of the states and of the United States. This crap has got to stop, because I'll tell you, if all you people out there want to divide the nation up into little bits and pieces, and this is your piece, and that's their piece, and you can't be a this unless you're a that,
yeah.
You're going to destroy this country faster than Phil Donahue or any of those socialists or the United Nations ever could. And it will be on your head, and you'll be held responsible for it. I can tell you that right now.
Well, I tell you what, as a Christian, I probably would not be surprised if I have to fight in a field right next to a homosexual or a Satanist or someone from any other group.
Well, if you're an American, you'd better be prepared and willing to do that, because that's what this country is all about. Everybody has the right to be whoever or whatever they want to be and worship at whatever altar they want to worship at in this country, as long as they do not injure the person or the property of any other citizen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the truth. And if you don't like that, and you want to make this country something else, then what you'll turn it into is another Dark Ages. And anybody you don't like, you'll just tie them to a pole, stack the faggots around their feet, and light the fire.
Yeah, that's probably what's going to happen if it does come to that.
It won't happen while I'm alive.
Yeah.
If I see anybody doing anything like that, I swear to God I will shoot them right on the spot. I will not allow this country to be tossed in the trash can by bigots and stupid people who don't even understand why and how or who founded this thing and for what purpose. Thank you for calling.
Have a good one.
You too.
Bye.
Well, folks, I've been warning you for a long, long time, and it's happening. Orange County has declared bankruptcy. Bankruptcy? Down the tubes. They're just the first of many that's going to topple across this country. Did you know that for the first time ever in the history of the market, investors have just lost money in a supposedly 100% safe money market fund? And they lost big money market fund. Hundreds of millions of dollars. It is the most important landmark collapse in mutual fund history. Which fund? Community Bankers, United States Government Money Market. Community Bankers, United States Government Money Market, took terrible losses in its portfolio of government securities, supposedly the safest securities there are. The managers couldn't beg, borrow, or steal the money needed to bail them out. They simply went out of business, and the investors were left holding the bag. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, at least 9 other major money market funds have exactly the same problems and will be toppling soon. One major money market fund has already taken a $257 million hit. The Federal Securities and Exchange Commission warns that 3 more money market funds are on the brink of collapse, but they won't tell you which money market funds they are. Is your money market fund safe? No. Is your bond fund safe? No. Some of the largest, best-known, most trusted money market funds in the world are stuffed with derivative investments that is going to collapse. In fact, It is. It's the scariest time in the history, and if you know somebody on Wall Street who will tell you the truth, you'll find out that they are running scared, scared to death. If you have your cash in a money market fund, get out. If you have your cash in bond funds, get out immediately. If you want income, put your money into short-term treasuries or into precious metals. And you know something? You can buy your T-bills direct from the United States Treasury. Did you know that? You don't have to go through a third party. And the experts are saying to get out of stocks now, right now. Now, you can sit back and wait until it all comes tumbling down around your ears, or you can do something to save yourself now. That's up to you. But what I just gave you, folks, is the truth. You can help protect what you've got by calling our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, right this moment. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now, ladies and gentlemen. Do it now. You see, if you don't, you got nobody to blame but yourself. Nobody to blame but yourself. Look around at your loved ones. What are you going to tell them if you lose it all? Or if you just lose half of it? What the heck? If you just lose 25% of it, what are you going to tell your loved ones? See, they're trusting you to take care of them. And you're looking at this phony inflated stock market and you're thinking you're doing the right thing. And I'm telling you right now, when the derivatives market collapses, you're sunk. You're finished, you're through, you're dead, period. It's as simple as that. I don't know how stronger I can put it. I don't know any other way to convince you. How come you didn't know that the Community Bankers United States Government Securities Fund failed? How come you didn't see that in the paper? Community Bankers U.S. Government Money Market. How come you didn't know about it? The SEC has warned investors that there are three other money market funds fixing to collapse, but they won't tell anybody the names of those funds. Wonder why. If they're going to collapse, why not let somebody save a little bit rather than everybody lose everything? But they won't tell anybody. Call somebody you trust on Wall Street. Ask them. If they're honest, they'll tell you what I just told you. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now, folks. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800. Buy coin. You'll sleep better. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes. Hi, Bill.
Hi.
Yeah, Todd from Wisconsin calling.
Hello, Todd.
Yeah, Bill, a comment on the Donahue show today. It's kind of interesting. One woman made a comment to one of the militia members that she welcomed Russian troops in this country to protect herself from them, from the militiamen, and I thought that was, she fits her definition of sheeple quite well there. And also I wanted to mention to you...
That's way over the edge. That's way beyond sheeple. I mean, that's down in the garbage dump. That's below the heap of trash. That's...
good for the Donahue show.
Oh, yeah. That's... Well, that's old Mr. Red Donahue, Mr. Commie.
Yeah. Bill, I was going to make another comment, too. I know you talk a lot about equipping militia groups, but another thing that I don't see mentioned too often is communication. And one thing that I think militia people should consider is amateur radio, which is a really good source of communication. In fact, I first learned about your show listening to a good group of patriotic people on 3950 on the amateur radio bands, and I just thought I'd
What you're talking about should be left up to individual militia units and communications and methods and frequencies and all of that stuff should never be discussed on any public radio program or in any public print magazine or newspaper if you want to have any kind of communications that you can trust for even 5 minutes, because after about 5 minutes you won't be able to trust anything that you even kept secret for this long.
Well, the nice thing about amateur radio is there's so many different bands you can...
You didn't get the message, did you? Shut up! Do you understand?
Okay, well, nice talking to you, Bill.
Nice talking to you, too. I wish you could take a hint a little better than that. There are some things, if you want to have an effective militia, you don't talk about. You just don't talk about it. Fortunately, the gentleman that was just talking is not in a leadership position, and anything he said doesn't reflect upon anything that the militia is doing, has done, or will do. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. It's nice to get through and be able to talk to you. I was a sheeple up to about a year and a half ago, and you're the one that opened my eyes. I listened to... Before you suggested it, I did listen to everybody. I talked show junkie. Listened to everybody. Started out when I was a young kid listening to Ray Breen and so forth and so on. But I noticed the media, the puppeteers, are up to something, and I was wondering if you could figure it out, that Rhino Bullet you're talking about. I'd like to put it on the table, look at it from all sides, and see what they're up to.
Don't get caught up in cul-de-sacs.
Well, I can understand that, but I was just—I think they're up to something.
Yeah, they're up to something. They want to disarm America.
Well, it's not—I don't think that's the way they slanted it. I know they want to disarm America, but they're saying—they're
trying to say that anybody that's interested in those kind of bullets is some kind of terrorist criminal who just want to kill cops.
I don't think the bullets exist.
Who cares? Don't fall into their thing. See, when you get spinning around chasing your tail and these little things that they throw out, like the Lawrence Livermore Laboratory threw out this thing, this big TV set and all this electronic equipment that the troops are going to carry with them in the field and plug it into a big generator, and it's going to tell them exactly where a sniper is when he shoots a bullet because it back traces the path of the bullet. Don't get caught up in all of that crap. It's bullshit. It's lies. Watch what they do.
Don't
pay any attention to all their propaganda. Watch what they do. That's the important thing.
Well, I'll agree with that. You're a very smart man. I hope that Constitution Party will take off and go across the nation, and we'll have some guy like you as president that realizes the need and the realizes what this country is based on.
Well, I hope so too, but it won't be me. I said it years ago when I started this that I'm a messenger, and that's all I am. That's all I'm ever going to be.
I said,
period.
Like you.
Okay. Well,
good evening.
Good evening. Thank you for calling. Yeah, we're looking for candidates, folks. But I'm going to tell you right now, it's not me. Never was and never will be. Not ever. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill. I've been listening to you for a while. I'll just put it straight out for you, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You're a veteran of Vietnam.
Yeah.
Combat veteran.
Mm-hmm.
I have some knowledge of that. I hear you talking about... I think you've seen the horror of war.
Yes, I have.
And I don't think you want to kill anybody.
No, I don't.
And I think that even if the worst happened in this country, and I've given this a great deal of thought, even if they took over, and it's just very likely that they're going to, I don't know if it's worth me, for me personally, going through that kind of pain again.
Well, that's something that you have to decide. Everybody has to make that decision.
But I hear you saying that occasionally. That, you know, not, you haven't said that in those exact words, but you talked about the pain of it.
Oh, yes, and I don't want to. When I came back from Vietnam, I swore to myself that I would never, ever kill another living thing, not even a mouse. I don't even like to step on bugs. I've had the ultimate hunt. I know what it is.
And I have, too.
Killing's not fun for me. It's a, you know, it's, I don't think it's, I don't feel good to go out and bag a deer during deer season. It doesn't do anything for me. I know people, it really pumps them up, makes them feel good. They like to eat the meat. That's fine. But that's not me. I don't want to do it, no. But if I have to, see, here's the difference. If I have to, I will. And I'll do it for my family, for my children, because I don't want them to live in the world that I know that these people are going to create.
You know, I tell you, it seems to me now, with the exception of your family, because that's something we can do, but the reality is I can't fight for freedom and give it to the guy down the street.
Well, then you don't deserve it, because...
No, you won't accept it. Freedom is something that you have to individually put yourself on the line for.
Whether he accepts it or not is not a consideration when you talk about these things. You either believe in and want for yourself and your family and your posterity freedom and liberty, or you don't. If you do, you have to fight for it. And if the guy down the street doesn't want to accept it, then somehow we have to deal with those people after it's all over. But we can't take into consideration their unwillingness to fight for what we know we need to fight for.
I'd like to hear what you think about, now, when we went to Vietnam,
mm-hmm.
we were, on some level, we were told that we were fighting for the freedom of these people, et cetera, et cetera. We learned different probably when we got over. I learned different, I don't know about you. I learned different when I got over there. Aren't you afraid of being snookered again?
No, because nobody's making this decision for me. Nobody's telling me where I got to go fight. Nobody's sending me off to a foreign country. I'm on my own soil, making my own decisions for my own reasons, understanding what I understand about what's coming and what I believe in. No, I'm not going to...
Well, what worries me about these militias is there's too many wannabes out there. You know, when the time comes...
What do you mean by wannabes?
Wannabe combat, wannabe...
Oh, man. If you were really in combat in Vietnam, you know that that's baloney.
No, no.
Combat sorts people out real quick.
I said the militias are full of wannabes.
Now, listen to me.
Yeah?
Combat sorts people out real quick.
Sure does.
They'll want to be until they have to, and then they will run if they're not the right kind of people. And that's the truth.
But the reality is, if this actually happens, the people who can... fight for freedom, will in fact do that. They don't have to belong to a militia.
No, you're wrong. I
know you want the militia.
No. It's not a question of what I want. It's a question of what's right, what's legal, what has set the precedent in the history of this country, what we can do under the law and what we can't do. And that is a fact.
Many
we must have militia because the militia is set in the precedent of the law and the history of this country. Anything else is a band of terrorists.
I would suggest no bands at all. I tell you what, it really is.
Well, I'll tell you what. When they come to get you, and you're the only one standing there, and there's nobody else with you, and there's no organization, no leadership, no plan, no nothing, you're going to be taken.
I'll be free.
No,
I won't be taken.
No, you won't be free.
I won't be. Yes, I will. I won't be taken.
What do you mean you won't be taken? There's only one list. If you're not one of them, you're one of us, and you're going to be taken. Don't you understand? There's one list.
Taken or?
Or what?
Or killed. See, I think one that can still die for freedom in many ways. And this is my own.
So you think we should all stay home, just wait till they come and kill us, and that then we're going to be free and just give them the world?
I know that I think it'd take a lot to get me to kill again.
All it would take for me is one of those ass breaths to just look crooked at my daughter. That's all it will take.
And I think that's a reality, and I think there's truth in that. You know, I really do. I just find that the people in the militia, some of the people...
Now, wait a minute. You don't know the people in the militia.
I know some...
You're making generalizations that you cannot make.
I know some people up here in the militia, yes.
Okay, you know some people.
I said there's some, and they make me uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable. They the some that I know, not all, some that I know, seem too anxious for this to happen. And the reality is that none of us really want it to happen.
The ones who seem too anxious for it to happen have either been real hurt by these people and want to just get it underway and get it over with, or they're stupid like we were when we went to Vietnam and couldn't wait to get into action to kill somebody, and when we got into action, wish we weren't there.
There's truth in those words.
You better believe there's truth in those. That's why I said combat separates people real quick. See, a lot of people who fought in Vietnam would not have fought if they had known that they wouldn't go to jail or wouldn't be shot by the commanding officer if they turned around and ran. In this coming battle, it's going to be nobody making anybody do anything.
No, you're absolutely right. Not at least on our side.
That's right.
See, I think on the other side, there'll be plenty of people making people do it.
Right.
And I wouldn't be too, you know, it would be nice to win. But I think that even in the losing, as an individual especially, even in the losing, there's victory.
Oh, yes. And even in the winning, there could be losing.
Oh.
If one of these radical jerk groups manages to get in power, if we win, we could end up with Bo Geitz really president of the United States.
And that's what worries me about some of these people.
It scares the hell out of me, I'll tell you.
By the way, have you ever, you know, speaking to him, because I'm calling you from Utah, and this is Bo Geitz country up here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he came out saying at first that he was the most decorated veteran in Vietnam. Has anybody ever gotten a lowdown? My understanding was that in August of 1965, in the defense perimeter of Da Nang, on the most far western foxhole that he was occupying, he was the most decorated veteran. You know what I mean?
I have no idea.
Well, what I mean is, he was claiming to be the most decorated veteran in Vietnam.
Well, I don't know if I don't know if that claim is true or not. But I would never disparage any medal that anybody ever won in combat, because I know what combat is. So where I may disagree with Geitz in what he's doing and with his involvement in Project Trojan Horse, with his involvement in the protection and the security of the drug planes that were coming into the United States from Central America when he was in charge of that unit down there. That was Operation Watchtower. And in his lying to people about his religion for several years before he finally came out and admitted what his real religion was. And I'm not making any disparaging remarks about the religion that he belongs to. What I'm making a remark about is the fact that he lied about it.
And that's what bothers me. I think he lied about his
lied about a lot of things.
Lied about a lot of things, I guess there's that in that Montana group. But anyway, I understand what you're saying.
Well, understand
it's the emotions.
It's not the Montana group. It's the one particular family that heads the Montana group. I think that there's probably some wonderful people in that Montana militia.
Oh, I'm sure there are.
But the leadership of the Montana militia is carrying baggage that we don't need, that's only going to end up hurting us in the long run.
I don't see how anybody who fought in Vietnam could, after Vietnam, deny that the black people are just as equal and deserve just as much as anybody else in this country. There were too many of them over there when I was there.
Well, I don't think anybody from Vietnam has ever done it.
No, they haven't.
Not that I know of.
And it seems to be the more elderly, and sometimes the younger. I don't understand the skinheads myself, but
skinheads are lost children who don't belong anywhere. No one would accept them except the Nazis. They took them in. They pretend like they love them. They really don't. They just want to recruit people. And so these people feel like they have a home there. They make them feel important by telling them that they're of a superior race. You have to understand that I can take lost children and make them do or believe whatever I want them to do or believe simply by giving them a place where they belong. The gangs in the inner cities take the place of families where there is no father and there is no love. When the kid gets a certain age, they look around to fulfill their manhood, and who takes them under their wing and makes them feel important and gives them a place where they belong, the gang.
Well, in keeping with the season, I'd like to wish you peace.
Well, I'd like to wish all of us peace, and I certainly hope peace is what we get. I don't think that that's reality, but I thank you for that sentiment.
Okay, goodbye.
Goodbye. Well, folks, we got time for one more call. Boy, we've had some good calls tonight. Some good conversations and some real good people here. All except for old Poopy Diapers, who couldn't even stay on to make his point. Good evening, you're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. I'm Jim from Oroville, California.
Hi, Jim.
And really enjoy your program.
Thank you. A
few items. One about your commie, our commie friend Donahue. Several people already told you that they deleted part of the Second Amendment when they flashed it on the screen.
Sure, they're liars, deceivers, manipulators.
Mm-hmm. And
there's a lot of Americans out there who didn't even know that they deleted anything, probably. I didn't see it, but it's the kind of thing I expect from Donahue and the rest of them.
Well, it kind of surprised me to see it edited like that. And somebody made a comment about the audience later that they were asleep on their feet and dead ahead of their time.
Yep.
And I'd like to know about getting into the Constitution Party and doing what I can to help.
Well, just send us a letter and say you want to be a part of it, and we'll send you all the information and the membership form, and we're going to request that you donate some money.
Okay. Next thing is, how do you get to these people like the audience of Donahue? How do you begin to educate? The few conversations I've had with my friends and neighbors, they think I'm some kind of a nut.
Well, let me tell you, as recently as 1989, when I first started talking about what I know, if I could get three people in the living room to hear what I had to say, I had to pay for all the expenses myself, and I usually had to drive 1,000 miles to get there to talk to these three people.
Wow.
And what has happened since then is amazing. We are making headway. We are waking people up. You see, people just never knew. Nobody ever told them. They didn't have the time, or they didn't bother to look. Everybody has the time, but that's the excuse, everybody. I don't have the time. So we have to go to them. And if you're talking to somebody who just doesn't want to listen, then you just have to leave things laying around where they'll find it. And eventually they'll come to you and say, hey, did you know that blah, 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 blah? You'll say, no, I didn't know. If it's their idea, they feel better about it.
Yeah, make them think it was their idea.
Yeah, I use that a lot.
I got your book a few days ago, and you costed me a lot of money on highlighters. I've got more colored highlighters on some pages than there is white.
Yeah. Did you notice that everything that was written in that book years ago is just now coming out on Radio Free America in the spotlight and the John Birch Society's New American Magazine and all these people traveling around saying that they're the ones who discovered it?
I listened to your contemporaries on the hour or two ahead of you. It's like a new discovery.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for calling. We're out of time.
Hey, and thanks for letting me talk to you, and keep up the work, and I will write your letter.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Good night. Good night, folks. God bless each and every single one of you, and please try tomorrow to wake at least one person up. And if you want to give somebody a gift straight from your heart that could change their life, give them a shortwave radio, the time and frequency of this broadcast. Happy New Year.